One.
Hello, good afternoon. This is Fabric Academy 2019-20. We are in class week number 2, Digital Bodies. And it will be our crash course with the use of digital fabrication through this week. So I will start sharing my screen. So digital bodies, it's digital bodies because we work mainly with the body, but it can be anything else. In this class, we will learn a little bit about the human figure, about how to scan ourselves or something else, and how we can digitize something and bring it to physical through the digital fabrication techniques. And a little bit we will talk about how we will have to use the lab and how is the workflow in the lab. Of course, each one afterwards in each of the labs, they will have to organize with the lab managers to understand how, where are the things, how the lab is working and everything. So we will see, this is the program outline. We will talk about human proportion. We will talk about a little bit how the fashion industry is changing because of the digital era. We will get a lot of inspiration from art and sculpture. We will see how mannequins have been used in haute couture in the textile industry. And then we will talk about the different programs and software that you can use for that. So the assignment of the week is basically to understand the workflow from obtaining an object into a digital form, scanning it. And we will see that there are many ways to do that. Then we will learn how to manipulate it, maybe to fix it or to cut it or to inflate it. Yes? And then how we can translate this 3D object into something that comes out physically. In this case, we are going to use the laser cutter. And the laser cutter is doing cuts in two dimensions. So we will have to translate this 3D object into flat pieces that they will be assembled afterwards. So this is an image of the very nice artist that has been a great inspiration for this class. He's called Anthony Gormley, and we will see more about him a little bit later. But let's start from the beginning, like how we represent the human body. Actually, the Egyptians, they used a grid system. So they divide the figure into a rigid grid that everything was even, and they divided the human figure into 21 equal squares from the eyes to the feet, with one half, two or two more squares from the eyes to the top of the head or the headdress. So you can see that this is completely mathematics, no? So it's very rigid. The Greeks, they made the kouros. They had influence from the Egyptians, but from the 7th century, they started to exhibit the marks of a spirit that they want a sense of freedom, and they want, and they had the curiosity to distort this rigid grid and to adapt it to kind of reality or kind of like flexibility for representing the human body. So they began to depict that the parts of the human anatomy in they were related to one another. So they start to understand that there is kind of proportion between the parts of the body. Unlike the Egyptians, that they divide everything in a grid, Then we start in the 7th century to understand that maybe there are some proportions. And then we have the Vitruvian Man that was created by Leonardo da Vinci in 1487, and actually it is accompanied by notes based on the work of the famous architect Vitruvius, and it actually talks about the proportional relationship of the parts and reflects this into a very universal design. So relativity, no? We relate the things of, we don't see only the eye, but we relate the size of the eye with the size of the nose. Everything has to be based in proportion. But then also there is kind of like a medical equilibrium of elements that ensures a stable structure. Like in the end, there are rules. Unlike the later in the years, in the 20th century, we have the Le Corbusier. He's the architect basically that made the rules for modern architecture and a lot of social housing. He's known to create these standards for how the houses and the architecture should be. We do not necessarily agree nowadays with what Le Corbusier has manifested, but he was one of, like, he was the architect that brought modern, the modern architecture into some rules. And he actually created his proper man, as he was very also pompous and he wanted to show that he's like a Leonardo da Vinci. So he made the modular, and it was a proportional system based on the Fibonacci series. So Fibonacci is the golden ratio. It's 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, and it goes on. And actually he believed that these proportions were evident in the human body. So the purpose of the modular was to maintain the human scale everywhere. So he also based designs of his buildings and how he sized the doors and the entrances and all the spaces. He actually sized all his building according to his modular, his man. And that's why in the modern architecture, you see a lot of small spaces with small doors, unlike the previous, like Renaissance, when you have the big buildings and the human want to reach God, no? So we make the house of God. So this was Le Corbusier. And so in general, we have to understand that when we are making something, it is not about making each part of the thing separately perfect. But it makes more sense to relate the parts. So even if all the parts are not perfect, if they are related with each other, then they bring a harmony and they bring an equilibrium. The Michelangelo's David in the 16th century actually is a very nice example that was used a lot in sculpture, where you can see these proportions. You can see exaggeration in the feet and in the hands. These hands are huge, which is not realistic, but it's a matter of expression, no? It's a matter of how the artist takes liberty with the natural proportions of the human body to achieve his expressive goals. And his Michelangelo's distortion were used to depict that David was very powerful and he was a hero and he was able to conquer Goliath. So we have a lot of artists and sculptures that they actually distort the proportions. They take this freedom in order to point out things in the human figure. Also, there are some books about the human figure and how this can be rationally explained. And we have Albrecht Dürer, that he was a painter and a printmaker. So he wrote four books that are called The Human Proportion in the 16th century. And he actually concludes that the human figure has five principles. One is the balance. So imagine that if you are want to do something physical, you need to make sure that there is balance so that your sculpture will not fall. The other is the proportion, and then you can have the freedom to be able to exaggerate or point out something if you want. You need to have a rhythm, like everything harmonically goes together. The emphasis, so you can emphasize or something, and the unity. And all of these, how are all of these actually related to fashion? It's very sad because fashion uses the human body as a white paper, as the white paper that a writer would use to write a book, no? So we have a mannequin, and this is our base to be able to create upon. And we have a white notebook, and we are a writer, and we have a pen, and we can start writing on the notebook. Or we are an urban planner, and we use the map as our tool to be able to draw upon the map. So this is how the fashion designer uses the mannequins. And this is not so it would be good to be more expressive, to be more influenced by art, to have more freedom in expressing the human body. Finally, in the end of the day, when we are taught in the architecture school how to make fashion, we all use a standard mannequin, no? And our question for this class is, what if we change the base and we have another medium to be able to create upon? What if we don't have, for example, a white paper that we can write our poem, but we have a glove that we can actually write, or a different medium, no? Like a different technology also. So this has, in fashion, we have many conventions. And actually, this is because we have gone to standards. We have the small, medium, large, extra large, and this is kind of universal, and it helps for mass production. But actually, we are all different. And if we have new technologies and we can actually give access to be able to customize and be able to design with our dimensions, with our personal custom dimensions, then we are talking about the digital tailor. So in the beginning, we saw this also in the first class, the made to measure, the bespoke, the mass production, and now we are heading towards an era of mass customization. It is more economical today to buy ready-made clothes that they are mass produced than making your own. Actually, before we have like before the 20th century, we have women providing with clothes to their family. Different social classes were highly distinguished by their outfits, and they were made by professional seamstresses and tailors, and they were fitted and styled differently for those made in home. So the only ones actually going to the shop for clothes were the sailors. Technological developments, pattern making insights, and mass production changed how clothing was constructed in the early 20th century. So the tailor was recognized as somebody that was the expert that could actually make a garment, no? So by the 1920, we have all the garments that they are ready to wear, sold in catalogs. And Levi Strauss was the first large apparel company to offer mass customization when they introduced the personal pair jeans. That it's called actually original spin. So we see that actually the fashion industry has evolved very quickly, and we are now today being able to shop online, adding our measurements and putting our custom sizes. And this is a very growing market. So here also you will have, when you will see the presentation on our wiki, you will have some reading, extra reading that we put. So basically what we are looking for is that we are looking for how we can take the measurements and make custom fit patterns and actually be able to even unroll the patterns directly, like design in 3D, and how we can unroll the patterns to flat, no? So we can unwrap a 3D representation of a garment and make a 2D pattern. And this is what we will be doing all the way through the process. But we need to start with the human body and the human proportion and the figure. So it is very important to understand how new technologies are actually bringing innovation. And it's very important to understand how art is ahead and is pushing for new technologies. So this is one of my favorite readings. It's called Old Media Digitized Make New Forms. And it actually talks about how the artists are pushing the scientists in order to develop programs and representation and visualization to be able to succeed in what they want to do in real scale and real life, no? So basically, in this paper, Fisher, that is the artist in The Rape of the Sabine Woman, he says that people see, I use the computer, so they say that I'm making computer art, but it's not about making computer art, it's about just using a new tool that everybody is using it. To carry out certain ideas, new technology is essential. Or to put it in another way, computer technology is making possible projects that a few years ago would have been utterly unfeasible. So the art that gets made is naturally limited by the technology available, but this doesn't stop the artist. The artist wants to liberate his creativity, and he will start and ask to say, how can we make that? And then the scientists, they will need to try to find a response. And this is what actually happened in both cases, in Anton Gormley, in this sculpture of exposure, because he wanted to make this sculpture and it was not possible to calculate the weight in order to be able to understand how the pieces of the metal would be put so that this sculpture would have balance. So he actually contacted a studio that they were doing mechanical calculations, that they were hardcore scientists, and he commissioned them to develop a software in order to be able to succeed this sculpture. So this is a very nice example, because we see that art is pushing and then you have the technological advances. And the same is with the rape of the seven women. Actually, this is a remake, but it is using the wax because it's like melting, as if it's melting. And it was also like in the past, like in the 16th century, that Leonardo da Vinci was commissioned to cast a bronze sculpture, and he was not able to because he was not a master of bronze. So he actually had to travel to another small Italian city to find a technician that he would be able to help him realize the bronze sculpture. So we see also that since the beginning, we have a lot of collaboration between what art wants and between what science can. And this is nice. This means that we want you to be free and to have like, try to push the limits. Because when you try to push the limits, then is where innovation can happen, no? We are constantly evolving and we have like new technical means, and we have the artists that they can actually manifest this in a very pure way, because you cannot see this so much in construction, for example, or in industry, no? So these are like different sculptures from Anthony Gormley, that he distorts the body and he actually talks and communicates through his expression. Of course, we are not going to be able to do something like that, but this is for you to also like think outside of the box and be able to express yourself in a different way. This is Anders Kirsar. So see here you have like, he's a Swedish contemporary artist, and he's like always talking about the tech, like the technique, or like it's looking realistic, no? He chooses to be actually surrealistic. But then you have also these kind of sculptures, where here you can see the digital tool. So Aaron Delbert and his brother, they do these sculptures that they use the CNC milling machine, which is the subtractive manufacturing, the one that is eating actually the wood. And intentionally, they create these traces so that you can actually see the machine-made parts of this very realistic sculpture. And of course, yes, you have like different expressions, and also like Katie Greenan, that she's exaggerating, and she's using, this is very digital, no? This is something that you can really easily do in the digital world. So it's a replication of the human parts, creating some kind of accordion or harmony. And even going into total abstraction, for example, like that, this is an exhibition actually called Digital Bodies. And it's a work that strives to get inside into form, aesthetics, and geometry by digitally dissecting a scan of sculpture of Maria Immaculata, which is this sculpture from the 17th century. And you can see different variations of this sculpture. So this is the original sculpture. And here is how artists, they distort and they use the digital in order to express and be able to show what kind of different effects this can have, no? Or even Matteo Pugliese, that he says that he always like uses the human figure as if it's something that it is coming out or like appearing, or it's always like half or cut. So he says that I believe that the human body is a complete and comprehensive alphabet capable of transmitting any concept of or emotion. Not by chance, it is one of the most rough subjects in the history of art, and it is true. The technique and the interpretation of the figure subsequently create that unique and personal language of each artist. And we have to understand the body as language and not as a white paper where I can write, or like a canvas, no? We need to understand that maybe due to convention in the school they have all the time the same white mannequin, but we need to understand that this is actually a language and this can talk and this can express, and how, if this expresses, then what kind of garments or what kind of things will I be able to design? So Matteo Pugliese is basically talking about more the interior of the human psychology, and he tries to express some kind of self-awareness and some needs through his sculpture. So it cannot be only visual, the thing that you want to express, but it can also be mental. And then we have Jaume Plensa. Jaume Plensa is Catalan, and he, of course, you see this big hat. He's from here, he's in Barcelona. He's a very known sculptor, and actually we collaborate. We know the workshop that actually makes the sculpture of this artist, and it is all digitally made. And it is also distorted, and it's also translated, it talks. And he's actually one of the most known contemporary artists that they do human sculpture and human figures. And they use robots and digital fabrication, molding and casting, and all of these techniques. You could be actually doing this here in this kind of setup, no? Of course, they also use marble and more noble materials, but these are metals. And then also you have this new kind of like, we talked already about it, no? We talked about the fact that new technologies are bringing new disciplines. So we have Lucy McRae and Bart Hess, that they call themselves body architects. And they use the body in order to communicate this kind of animal-like or this kind of imprint, or to exaggerate, or to talk about, like here you can see the spine, it's an inflatable structure. And they create these imaginaries, these fantasies that they merge, actually. They talk a lot about how we merge the biology of our body and the technology. And they create this kind of dialogue that, from the clothes that you can recreate body parts, and then it's all like executed in kind of a performance, or like this. What does this makes us feel? It makes us feel like we are suffocating, no? So it's very easy, but it's very communicative. And also like Bart Hess, that he's a very young artist and designer, Dutch. He graduated from the Design Academy in Eindhoven, and he was in the man and identity department. So we also see that we can have sociology and psychology and how the social sciences can actually express through art and through digital media. Both of them, they work with new materials and they work with new technologies. But in the real world, we have a lot of art in the making of the mannequin. And it's very interesting also to understand how mannequins are made. So this studio is very known for leading the aesthetics of the mannequins through the years, through the time and the period. It's Ralph Puccin. It's actually an international furniture, lighting and mannequin company from New York City. They began in the 1950s. They were starting fabricating mannequins. And they also describe how the stereotypes have been changing through the years, because you can see that in the 60s, maybe you have a mannequin that is a little bit more fluffy, and then you have another period that you have the very skinny one or the more artistic. So he actually kind of, with his mannequins that they were coming out in the different years, he's actually manifesting how the body stereotypes also were changing through the years. And he works with all of the designers. He makes custom-made mannequins for the biggest houses of fashion designers. And there was this exhibition, actually, that it was showing how his studio is and how his work is. So you normally, in order to make a mannequin, you would want to make a mold. And the mold would be from fiberglass and from plaster. And then you would cast plastic, or you would fill in with fiberglass inside. And then you would have one mold that you can use many times, which is the negative. And then you would cast inside in order to be able to make all of these copies. So these are like single, let's say, standalone, unique molds that then they can reproduce the mannequins. But then you have like digital fabrication, and this actually what it does, it allows you to not use a mold, to use another technique, to use another figure. And what we did is that we started creating these digital mannequins in 2014. This was a mannequin for the first exhibition. And it was actually a very big problem, because we wanted to make an exhibition, but we wouldn't have like big budget. And we realized that buying mannequins is very expensive. If you want to buy a mannequin that is a little bit better or good, it will be like 100, 200. It can go like thousands, but I mean the cheapest ones, unless they are secondhand. And then hiring, like renting mannequins, was also extremely expensive. And in the end, we say, okay, we just make our mannequins. And we started in 2014, and it was something that was replicated also in many laboratories of the world, because we put the files online. And in 2018, Issey Miyake, he actually made these mannequins inspired from the digital fabrication techniques. Of course, these are in acrylic, so they are still very expensive. But since then, we have been making different mannequins and also using them in exhibitions and in shops, no? And these are different, like, fabrication techniques. So here, actually, you can see what we call a waffle structure, and this is how we will be calling it from nowadays. It's when you have, so this starts from a 3D object that we translate into planar surfaces, and then we can actually assemble it. It's like a puzzle, and this is what we will be calling from now on a waffle structure. You can define the thickness of the material that you want. You can define the angles that they intersect. You can define how dense this is. And actually, in this case, you can see that the base is a lot denser than the upper part. And you can also see that where the torso is also is denser. So we actually use horizontal slices more or less according to where we need to have higher definition of the body. And this is going to be called stack slices. So actually this is having the 3D model and cutting it in horizontal or in vertical or in the direction that you want, but being a fool, and it will be called stacked slices. And you will cut according to the thickness of the material that you have. And your material can be cardboard, or it can be wood, or it can be foam, whatever. In this case, we have a bended composite. So we use the vacuum forming machine. And we have a very abstract representation of the body, you know, of the mannequin. Actually, this was more like a sculpture, and it was not so much of a usable mannequin in the end. It's only using the least amount of lines that you need in order to be able to define a body. And how it is done with molds, as you can see here, that they are created with a milling machine. And then you use wood that you bend and you glue, and you leave it in vacuum, in pressure, so that it can glue like that. And then this one is the one that was actually the most, let's say, reproduced. Actually, it is very nice to go and visit different fab labs and see this mannequin in many places. And it is a single file that you can mill in the milling machine, and then you can assemble. And also it has like the different like emptiness. So it's like one empty, one wood, one empty, one wood. And it's very nice because you can actually see it from the front, and it can be transparent. And when you see it from the side, it plays with this kind of transparency. And the last one that we made was the one that was 3D printed. And this one is using a big 3D printer. So it's using a WASP. Actually, this was a kind of a sponsorship from WASP Spain for the exhibition in Fab 14 in Toulouse, because they printed for us these mannequins. And they bring this with a big scale 3D printer, and it actually takes only 1 hour and a half to produce. And this is radical. And this is how, why we talk about Raphael, we talk about the sculpture, and we talk about Raphael Pucci, and we see that you have to make the molds, and you make, this will take a lot of time, and then you need to post-process it. And then we see that actually you can very smoothly enter in a digital flow process that you can have a mannequin made out of plastic. This is plastic PLA, corn-based, biodegradable, but not disposable, biodegradable. So you can have this in 1 hour. And this can be a scan of the body. And this was the exhibition. Then we have like stack slices here from WAG in the first year. They They had all the people scanned together, which is quite funny. And then you can also, then there's a company, and it's actually very bright. And also we have some students that they did this kind of flat mannequin. It is polypropylene that is laser cut. And then when you assemble it, you can make a mannequin. So imagine that you can travel in an exhibition with your mannequin and you can assemble it. And then you can disassemble, put it in your suitcase as flat. And so we have some students that they also tried that. This was more like into the arts. It's a 3D printed man. It was kind of artistic piece that I made in 2014. And it is 2 meters, so it's very big, and it's made out of pieces. So here you can see that if you have, for example, a small machine, now you need to understand that the thing that you want to make needs to be kind of a puzzle, so that you can have the pieces and then assemble them together to make something that is bigger. And there are many examples like that. Actually, this year in Egypt, they were making the Nefertiti, which is the model of the sculpture. They were making this out of like 3D printed pieces that everybody printed, like everybody in the world, they had to print the piece and then they brought it and then they assemble it there. And then also you can find a lot of these kind of parametric filters online, or you can even find many different models online that you can download already something. So we have also files that they are ready to produce. So we don't need to travel with the mannequin, we just send the file of the mannequin is produced locally, and these are files that they are shared, they are open source. But we also have a big pool of contributors, and you can find a lot of, in 3D printing, you can find a lot of things, everything actually, on this platform that is called Thingiverse. So you can find, for example, the 3D scan of Andy Warhol face, or you can find different models that you can actually distort, remix, reproduce. And then we have this new mannequin, which is like a robot, and it appeared like 1 year and a half ago. It's called Eureka. Evrika in Greek, and it is using pistons in order to be able to adjust. So this is an adjustable mannequin, so you can actually put the dimensions and then it will adjust by inflating with pistons inside the size. And not only like, so basically, okay, we talk about how the mannequin is the language. We talk about how the mannequin is the language of communication, how the body and the human figure has been represented in the arts, how in fashion they use it, what if they use it in a different way, more like creative. How we can actually make different mannequins, with which techniques, which technologies, and how are the new technologies facilitating the production and the customization. But it's not only used for that, it's also used in serious applications, and it is actually helping a lot of people with using assistive technologies and inclusive design, because we have pieces that they can be fabricated, that they are functional. So we are not talking about using a mannequin for draping or designing something, or because it is art, or because it's a sculpture, but we can use it for something that it can be of use. In this case, this is Victoria Modesta. She's a singer and performer, and she has one limb. So she has various different artists that they are creating limbs for her. And actually, we use a lot of this scanning and designing and modeling techniques for exoskeleton, for prosthetics. And actually, this is for a child, for example, that is young and maybe he doesn't have like a hand. With this kind of additive manufacturing and with this kind of customized design, this child can feel cool having a prosthetic hand, no? He's not like excluded from the society, but it's included and actually is cooler than the others, no? Because he's like kind of a Robocop or like the artist that the child will want, no? So we have many companies actually that they are working on prosthetics and assistive technologies. And here you can ask for customization for like you can ask how you want it. You can put your prints and you can they are like alternative. And then we go to the different software. So here's a big list. And so the workflow is that we obtain a 3D model, and there are four ways to do that. The first way to obtain a 3D model is to model it. So you use a program and you model. The second way is to scan it. And the third way is to download it. And the fourth way would be to remix it. You find something and you manipulate it and you remix it, no? So you combine the two. So three ways of obtaining a 3D model, we say the three. Model it, scan it, or download it. There are various platforms online that you can download. So we obtain the 3D model, and then we need to manipulate it. And we need to manipulate it so that we can actually translate this into flat boards that we can later on assemble in these techniques that we've seen, which is waffle, stacking, radial. There are like triangulation, there are many techniques. So these are different programs that you can try. These programs are mainly for fashion design, and the only one that is free is called, here it's called Valentina, but they changed the name. It's called Seemly 2D, but if you click Valentina, it will direct you to the new software. This is an open source program for making patterns for fashion. And it can do also the sizing. So it's very good. But there are many different kind of programs, like many companies like Zara and Inditex, they use the OptiText. Now we have a lot of schools that they are learning the Cloth3D, which is a simulation also. It can simulate how the cloth goes on it, but there are various ones. Then you have various 3D modeling programs. So you can, and here you can see like some of them are free, some of them are not free. If you are into free software, I definitely recommend Blender. You can do simulation, you can apply filters, you can, it's not the program that I am used to because I got trained as an architect, so I use AutoCAD and Rhinoceros. But if you are new, I would actually recommend SolidWorks. SolidWorks is also very powerful because it's parametric, so it has history. So if you start with a sphere and then you start manipulating the sphere, then you will be able to go back, do some changes, and it will automatically apply all the things that you did afterwards and it will update. But it also has a lot of, you can visualize the forces and where the things break, or like many technical. And you can use Fusion 360, you can use FreeCAD if you like to 3D model by programming, so you write code, for example. And then there are some like programs such as like Sculptris or SculptDM that they are more intuitive and you don't need to do a lot. You start with the base and then you can sculpt the model. It's like as if you were doing this with your hands, but you're doing it with the mouse. So actually, from tomorrow, it would be good that everyone of you has a mouse, because it's very difficult to work with a computer and the 3D modeling programs without a mouse. And also, ZBrush is very nice. So here you have a big list. And what we are going to, what we have been using for this assignment was this software. It's called Make Human. So this is I will talk about it a little bit later. So this is an overview. And then you have a softwares, different softwares for weaving and knitting embroidery. Also, I'm putting this here because if you are using a digital embroidery machine, software is very, very expensive and proprietary. So you don't have access to any open programs in order to use it. So here we made a selection for all programs that they are open and that you can use for digital embroidery. So now we can go to the scanning part, which is, you can do this, so you don't need necessarily to scan all of your body. If you find, for example, a Barbie that you want to scan, or if you find, it's not a good example, the Barbie. If you find something that you want to scan, you can scan that. It's more that you also have your own mannequin, so then after you can work on it in your further assignments. You can scan your body, you can scan your friends, or you can scan, or you can even use a program to do it. It's not necessary. So if we talk about scanning, there are various methods for doing that. And it's very interesting because it has been some kind of technology that was not at all accessible. And now with the open source and with sharing, you can find solutions of very low cost scanning. So 3D scanning is a technique that we collect data and we capture the three dimensionality of a shape, an object, a person, or an environment. 3D scanners and software that goes with the scanner, because it's always the scanner and the software that goes with it, are very powerful tools because you can use it in various industries. You can use it, it's very loud here. You can use it in the teeth. So, you know, like, you can use it a lot in the dental industry. You can use the scanner in video games. You can use in animation movies. Nowadays that you put the suit and then they can actually animate you. You can use the in automotive and aeronautics. And these machines have been very, very expensive. And it's a field actually that, like the 3D printing revolution, now we are also having like the scanning revolution, that it's becoming more and more accessible so that anybody can scan. So you can find different applications. So the applications for 3D scanning are for computer vision. You can track objects and people. You can actually reconstruct 3D environments. You can use it for interaction. So you can use it for playing games and character animation for gesture. You can use it for a motion analysis. So for when you're breathing, they can actually scan you and analyze your breathing with that. Each of the technologies has its own limitations. And we have four kind of different scanning techniques. One is photogrammetry, one is laser scanning, contact-based scanning, and structured light scanning. So, laser triangulation is the technique that measures the deformation of the laser ray on a 3D shape. So, we are projecting with a laser, and we are measuring how the distance and the deformation, and then we can use this 3 data and triangulate to be able to put the point where the point is. Photogrammetry is another technique that you take many pictures around the object and then you can put them together and reconstruct the 3D scene. This needs a lot of computational power. So if your computer is not so powerful because it's old, using a photogrammetry technique may be very heavy for your computer because what it needs to do, it needs to put all the images together. So you have to take many images all around, then it needs to reconstruct this. So structured light is again using the light. So normally when we want to recognize something, we will be sending a laser beam or light, and then we will be getting back the deformation. And contact base is when actually you have samples of points by by using a probe, like that you have a contact and it tells you it measures. And the laser, so these are all like very like techniques that they are not accessible. We will see the laser beam and the photogrammetry, and you will see different kinds of tools that we can use for that. But these are the five techniques, the different five techniques of scanning. This is interesting because when we are talking about 3D printing also, it's not one way of 3D printing. There are many types of 3D printing. So it's the same here. There are many kinds of different scanning techniques. And actually, you can go online and you can buy a scanner if you want, but you will see that it has been until now very, very expensive. So in order to be able to get, and actually there are different scanners for different applications, because if you want to scan a building, it's a lot different than scanning a person. Because you need to have a different depth and a different kind of technology. So there are different scanners, and what we are going to be using is kind of a hack. We have different labs, and each lab has his own scanner. So I can present the different scanners first by starting with this hacking technique, which is the Kinect. So actually, and the software of Scanect. So the Kinect is it was developed for gaming. Do you know the Kinect? It's developed for actually the Xbox, and it uses an infrared light in order to be able to that people can play, and it is thought to capture the human emotion. So it's very good because it is actually what we need to be able to scan something that has this kind of size. And then you have the Scanect software, which is actually very, very low cost. It costs like 200 euros. I mean, in the lab we have the license and we will be able to use it, that it connects to the Kinect. So what happens is that the Kinect uses an infrared light and it captures 9 million data points per second. So it captures all these points and and it is very, very low cost. You could also actually use a webcam as well for scanning by using the infrared light. So let's see how the Kinect works.
Microsoft's Kinect has a depth sensor that can tell how far away things are. In this stream, brighter
can you
colors
hear?
Are closer, darker ones are farther away. This video will explain how it does this, which is pretty clever.
Yes, we can hear.
How many people initially thought it worked. Suppose you wanted to figure out how far away things were from a camera. How can you tell the difference between a small nearby rabbit and one that's larger but farther away? They both could look the same from the camera. This is where a second eyeball or camera can help. If we draw lines from a rabbit to both cameras, they form a triangle, so we can calculate how far away the rabbit is using some trigonometry. It's not as simple as just adding two cameras, though. You have to make sure you're drawing lines from the same rabbit. If there are two rabbits in the scene, how can I make sure I'm measuring from the same rabbit? And what if the rabbits are all red and the background is red, too? The Kinect can actually handle this case. Instead of a second camera, it has an infrared projector that paints the same invisible markers like this. Now the rabbits can be differentiated no matter what the colors are. Whenever the camera sees a one, it knows that object is sitting along the one line projector, so we can again triangulate the distance. Likewise, for any other number, it automatically knows its angle too.
It's all based on triangulation.
Now if you take a night vision camera and look at the projection from the Kinect, you won't see a grid of numbers, but rather a random speckle pattern. This accomplishes the same goal, though, because no group of specks looks like any other. So the Kinect automatically knows the angle of every group, just like shown before. The downside of this technology is that it can only work indoors because sunlight would wash out the speckle pattern. And similarly, multiple Kinects would confuse each other.
So, if you're using the Kinect and the Scanect, you should understand that this is working with an infrared light. So, if you, for example, you're going outside in like full sun, then it will not be able to capture anything. So, it is limiting, it's a limited technology, and it works better with lower light, even in the night, for example, it works better. But it's not for everything. You cannot go and scan buildings or being scanning outside in the sun. Then we have the photogrammetry, which is actually an older technique, and it's by using many pictures that they go around. So the methodology here is that you have to go around on the same level. You have to go around a little bit down one circle and a little bit up. So actually you have to make three circles, 360 around the object in the three different directions in order to be able to have a very good point cloud, which is all these points that we capture. And then after, what happens is that we create a mesh that is doing a mesh triangulation. You have many programs that you can find online, and I'm sure that there are even more every day, because this is kind of like the, we are at this moment of the breakthrough of the scanning technology, so you will even find scanners for or applications on your mobile phone, and it would be great if you can test them and see what happens. I was trying to use one. It's like very, very low resolution, but let's see how it could come out. So you can also have, you have this case scan 3D. You have, this one is quite nice. It's called the Reconstruct Me. And also you have the milk scanner. So the milk scanner is an even older technology where you actually submerge an object into milk, and then you start taking pictures from above and from the front, and you start adding the same amount of milk every time. So it actually gives you all the different like contours, and then you can reconstruct it. And they are very nice tutorial. If you want to try the milk scanner, it's quite funny and it works. It works. It's very nice. But also you have more like professional scanners. Most of the labs, I think they have this scanner. It's a hand scanner and it's called Sense. Then you have other programs. This one is for touching, like you move the robotic hand and you move it where you want, and then it reconstructs directly on the screen. So you can actually have a pen that goes around and then it scans and it reconstructs it. And then you have laser scanning. So it's using laser beams, and it's known as LIDAR technology. It's taking the distance measurement at every direction. The scanner rapidly captures the surface of the shape of the objects or buildings or landscapes, and it constructs a full 3D model, combining a multiple surface model obtained from the different angles, more or less like the photogrammetry, no? So then, yeah, you have a lot of different techniques. So here, the principal basically is analyzing the photographs. And there was this very nice software that we used a lot in the past that was called ReCap. It was from Autodesk and it was open, but open. Now it closed, and this is also kind of a big question about, because we have been like using a lot of training material and like a lot of software from that was open, and then suddenly one day it closed. So imagine that many educators that they had their kind of methodology, then they had to not base it anymore on this, because in the beginning it was open and now it was not anymore. And you have the structure. You have this one, which is like very very easy, like with your phone. You can start like scanning everything from nowadays, from like from today. You have the Q clone, different scanning software. And one that we used a lot, and it's quite nice to try, it's called Regard 3D. And all of this, maybe it seemed like that we see different applications, but the application that is most like developed in terms of the digital world and in terms of like the what we are doing in the how we are communicating through the internet and through like video conferencing system and Skype calls or WhatsApp calls is the facial recognition. But this uses more the webcam, and actually we start like scanning the what we are talking about when we are talking, and then we start understanding repeated patterns, how things are repeated, and understanding contextualizing together with the language, with what you hear, we can start understanding and learning expressions, no? And understanding, for example, if I am doing like that, maybe I am angry. If I'm doing like that, maybe I am happy. And this is all used nowadays with algorithms for also like artificial intelligence, and all of this is an application for from scanning techniques. In the fashion world, yes, there are many brands and there are many kind of like products that they are using body scanning, so that actually you can combine body scanning with personal coaching. So you can have both the stylist, like that somebody that will actually make you custom fit garments, but at the same time register your development, your evolution, and be kind of like a personal coach. So they are combining the health and like weight and height and all of this together with the body scanning. There are many companies actually that they appear in that. The idea of the future is that you go and you have experience in the shop where you enter the shop, you have yourself scanned, then you walk around, you play an augmented reality game, and by the end of your trajectory, you have your custom knit pattern because it was made on in the store at this moment, no? And this is what we call micro factories, what they call, or what they call on-demand production, from file to factory, all of these things. So this is something that also many companies actually, they came and they say, can we put this body scanner in the showroom and then have the people like having their own platform, and my clients, I have the database of my clients, and then I can also tell them like, maybe this is for you, like also like to advise. There is a female body visualizer, and what we have used in the past, and it's quite fun, is called Make Human. I mentioned this before. Make Human is a program that is used for character making, but you can actually put the dimensions of your body, and it will create a 3D mesh of the person that you want. You can, it's open, it's free, so anybody can use it. And it's also compatible with the other open source software that I was telling you, which is Blender. So you can animate also the person. And then we can use both the scanner and the Make Human in order to obtain the 3D figure. And then afterwards, we can use various programs, but what we have been using in Fabricademy, and of course, you are welcome to use other kinds and show us different possibilities, is called Slicer 3D. It is online, it is free, but we don't know how long it will be free. So it is very good because there was another, it was one software called Make, 123D Make before from Autodesk. Now they made this, which is called the Slicer for Fusion 360. It is very handy. It's very easy to use. And this, once you have obtained your 3D model, your 3D body or your Make Human or whatever you want, you can manipulate it in that various programs to fix the mesh, and then you can put it into Slicer where you will have to put the dimensions of your boards and the thickness, and then you can play with the technique that you want, the waffle or the... So you can also find tutorial in Fabricademy, tutorials on Vimeo of how to use the slicer and how to manipulate the mesh from Rhino, going from Rhino to slicer and vice versa. If you want, there are many tutorials that we did the last year. And also, I think we will be doing one tomorrow. So here. You can see, you can visualize, it can also tell you what is the order of how to put the things together. It's kind of like making your life easy. Before that, because we did this also before Slicer, before the existence of this program, what we would do is that we would either do it manually, so basically, put the pieces one by one in the 3D model and then make the hole so that each one fits. And then what we did in at least here, we used the rhinoceros with Grasshopper, which Grasshopper is a plugin and it's parametric, so you can actually do this by coding. Always remember that the pieces, when they join together, you need to understand what is the tolerance, because maybe your thickness of the material is 3 millimeter, but then if you have to put them together, maybe you need to have 3.1 hole, because then they have friction, no? So first you need to make a tolerance test always, and then after cut everything. And then you can use laser cutting techniques. You will do some kind of tutorial in your lab. You can use 3D printing techniques, but it's impossible to print a scaled one-to-one mannequin if you don't have a big scale 3D printer, but you can also may use it for using the small miniature of your 3D model. This is 3D printing. Or you can use CNC, numerically controlled, numerical control cutting, which is subtractive manufacturing. So you start with a block and it's like sculpturing, taking out material. So here you have additive manufacturing, when you start from nothing and you start building, extruding or solidifying in some way. And here you have subtractive manufacturing, extracting. No, so these are also some limitations. Actually, one of the first artists that she used this kind of digital fabrication to represent her body was Eva Goldgemuth. I'm not very good in saying this, but she was doing like a very long investigation in because she did this in 1997. So back then, we would have a USB. We would have a floppy disk. So imagine what kind of data you can put in a floppy disk in order to mill this. So she was actually creating a 35 megabyte data set of her body, digitally scanned, and she actually has this ongoing series of works that pulls and pushes and transforms the female figure into a variety of digital works, from animation, interactive experiences, sculpture, installation, and she's one of the pioneers of using the human body. She manipulates the source code, and her body has become the source for a new provocative ways to represent the female figure. And yeah, so in general, what we already mentioned is that all machines, they use coordinates. What they need is that they need to read a text document, which is called G-code, that will read coordinates X, Y for the laser cutter, X, Y, Z for the 3D printer, X, Y, Z for the CNC, X, Y, Z and A, B, C for a robot that has more freedom You have also like five axis milling machines that they can rotate. So you have different kind of machinery, but all of them, they read coordinates. They read where the X, Y are, and then they move. They have their own language, but imagine what kind of data set you need to send in order to be able to tell the machine to move all around this path. So in that moment in 1997, I think it was quite of a technological advance to do that. And also you can have molding techniques. I wouldn't recommend that you make a mold technique, but here you can see that you have different kind of molds. So in the molding technique, you would use to make the negative, and then you can have one part mold or two part molds that they press each other. Three, if you have more complex, four. And this is also why 3D printing is revolutionizing the way we make, because in making molds, there are some kind of limitations, or then you need to understand a lot how to dismantle everything and how many different parts you need to have to make something complex. But when you're doing additive manufacturing, when you are like 3D printing, then you have the freedom of any kind of complexity. You have no limitations in the. But molding also, you can. The idea of molding is also to be able to reproduce. No, like that you can make also copies. And also, bending and pressing, as the mannequin that we show that we've seen that was very like pre-form. That we use the mold and then the pattern, and then we use resin composite. So if you feel more advanced and you want to make your sculpture for this week, you can go ahead and use any kind of technique that you feel comfortable with. For the basics, for the ones that they have never scanned before and they have never 3D modeled or they have never went to the process of the work flow, we recommend the laser cutting. You can think about doing, wait a second, I can stop sharing. Yes, okay. You can think about using this as something. It can be later your table, or it can be your lights, your lamp, or it can be, yeah, I don't know, your. We also had, for example, students putting plants and growing plants in them. You can use it as you want. You can, if you feel more comfortable with digital fabrication, you can actually do something more elaborate, something more artistic, or something with any kind of technology. But if you are starting now, the idea is that you can be an expert of laser cutting by the end of this week. So, last thing, to talk with you before we go to questions is the rules and safety. So yeah, keep calm and tie your hair up. Wear goggles, wear gloves when it is needed, of course, no? When you're doing something that you're cutting a wood or you are cutting or you're using something hot, you should wear gloves. If you're milling something and or if you're making noise, you should protect your ears. You can never come in the lab downstairs with flip-flops. It's not it's forbidden. If you're doing something with composites or if you're doing something with dust, we can give you dust masks. And afterwards, wash your hands. And always remember that it's this is a shared space. There are many people using it, and it's nice to leave it better than you found it. Ask your lab the opening hours, the booking system, if there is any. Try to be collaborative with the other functions of the lab. This program is a program that requires a lot of lab use and it has a lot of freedom. So we just need to advise before to always be correct and always like try to collaborate with the people that they are trying to help us in the lab. In their lab, maybe not food and drinks, but there are some labs that there is food and drinks. I mean, it's better that you are not eating and drinking next to the milling machine, because then you are eating also polyurethane foam. If you break any machine, just go directly to the person that is in charge. Machines break all the time. So don't feel bad. Machines will break. It's better that they don't break, but if they break, then you just tell, okay, now the machine is not working. This is, has happened, because then the person will just fix it for the next one. I will stop sharing. I can hear your comments. If you have any questions, is it clear, the exercise, for everyone?
Anastasia, I do have a question. I've been researching the slicer, the 3D slicer, and I'm not finding if it's not with 360. I'm not sure if it's the same software.
So what are you using when you are doing this in your lab, Roberto?
Normally we use Fusion 360, the slicer type, or the grasshopper.
Yeah. So this I will send you here in the chat the link. Wait. Here. You have it in the chat. Ta-da.
Thank you. Ah, what is that?
It's an app. Yeah, it's an app. Yeah, for as I said before, for you can start with also making a small model if you want. You can 3D print. You can laser cut in a thinner, and then you can use different scanning techniques. You can be more creative, less creative. It's a matter, basically, it's a matter of you starting being comfortable with using the laser cutter and you having a first contact with 3D modeling. And that's it. I hope that you got a lot of inspiration and that you will make very nice things for next week. And you will tell us more about new apps and new scanners and new facial recognition technologies all over. Any questions?
Yeah.
It's working, Roberto?
Jean-Marie from Pablabon Le Fay in Geneva. I just want to say that Fusion, Slice for Fusion, you do not need to buy Fusion 360. If you can download, yes, Slicer for Fusion for free, they can use it.
Yeah. Yes. We don't know for how long, but for the moment we can.
You have to preserve that install app.
Well, I can find the grasshopper definition and send it to you on Slack. We have activated our Slack. Or you can find it. Okay. Any more questions? Any other questions? For the ones that they need more help and they feel a little bit lost, they can talk with their remote instructors, and they can also see the tutorials that we have from last year for this class, because I made a tutorial for the slicer. Okay.